Welcome, Earthlings.
So
what?
Dramatic.
Isn't
so
it dramatic?
Dramatic.
Thank
it's
you.
Perfect.
This is something from my old high school days.
You used to sing that?
Yeah, actually, I did. That was actually something. I mean, it wasn't me playing it, but it was something that we played in my high school band, and it became a big kind of theme for us, and we really had a blast playing it. So I thought that was very appropriate, especially for our guest. This is Planet Mitch, by the way, and this is Wednesday, August 8th. And this is episode number 3 of the brand new Planet 5D podcast. And we're going to call this episode Rumor Central because we have a very special guest with us.
Mitch, it's Thursday, by the way.
Oh, gosh, you're right. See? Thanks, Pamela. Actually, see, that's what happens when you make show notes and you start trying to read from them. Because I actually just changed the date. While the intro was playing, I'm like, oh, this is not the 7th, this is the 8th. But I didn't catch the Wednesday part. Oh, well, maybe our new producer will take care of that, and it'll be much better than my old producer, which is me.
Ooh, I got big shoes to fill.
Pamela's going to be our producer from here on out, right? Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. I'm going to make you write all the show notes. Mercy. For those of you who don't know, I've got this new also little intro line that says, the Planet 5D podcast is the best place in the universe to hear the latest in photography, photography and video news, as well as interviews with industry leaders and superstars like our guest today, who is Craig Blair from canonrumors.com and LynnReynoldsCanada.com. Go ahead.
How you doing?
Hey! Glad to have you here. I'm excited. I'm always glad to have a good friend like Craig on the show because it makes it so much easier on me because I know Craig will just talk and talk and talk.
That's not true, but okay.
I know it's not true. Barry and I know.
Is this the Craig I know? Because I'm confused now.
How's it going, Barry?
So those are our two guest hosts, co-hosts, by the way, Pamela and A-N-N Berry. Maybe I should just quit saying Ann, but it just rolls off the tongue, really. Pamela and Berry and Barry Andersson. The male voice is Barry Andersson, just in case you're confused, and Pamela is the female voice. Just want to get that straight.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, man, it's getting deep. All right. In today's show, we're going to talk about news, and we're going to talk to Craig about his two booming enterprises, and we're also going to throw in something new, which is going to come up in just a second, and I really need to have some great intro music for this, but I haven't come up with this, but this is going to be called the Meteor Round. Bum, bum, bum. Doesn't that sound dramatic?
You're always so dramatic.
Audio cue.
Yeah. Well, I'm gonna just try this one, and what I'm gonna do. That doesn't sound very never mind. Pamela, you were saying earlier
so
that your
sorry,
tongue was.
That was my fault.
I cannot get my tongue working today either. So maybe we'll do this one. Does anybody recognize that sound?
No.
Isn't it like a
that is something that we all should know because that is the sound of Sputnik, the very first satellite orbiting the Earth. Okay, that put one everybody to sleep.
I wasn't alive for that, Mitch.
Oh, well. Touché.
Perfectly
good one.
Timed, Craig. Perfectly timed.
Very, very good, Craig. And by the way, I came up with something in the pre-show while I was talking to Craig, and I've come up with a new nickname for him, and we're now going to call Craig the Loose Cannon. Get it?
Nice.
Cannon rumors. Ooh, bad pun. See, I did the wrong one again. I did the wrong one. Oh, that's better. All right, meteor round. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask several questions of Craig. We're going to try to get him to loosen up a little bit because he's cool. He's so okay. What we're going to start with the real simple ones, and then we'll move up to the harder ones. All right. What is your favorite movie?
Shawshank Redemption.
What is your favorite ice cream?
My favorite ice cream?
Right.
Guinness and cheddar.
What?
Seriously. Yeah. I make ice cream at home, so Guinness and cheddar is my favorite ice cream. It's phenomenal.
Wow.
I smell yeah. A third business is going to be taking over Ben and Jerry's.
If you were going to be a planet, which one would you be?
I know what I want to say, but I'm not going to say it. Pluto. Pluto's not a planet, so we'll pick Saturn. We'll do Saturn.
Wow.
It's pronounced Uranus.
Thanks for the images.
It is a shame that Pluto is no longer a planet, isn't it?
I know. I liked it, but it was the outside guy. And, oh, well.
All right. Here's one my daughter came up with the other day. This is a grammar question. Which is correct? Oh, no. The egg yolk is white, or the egg yolk are white?
The egg yolk is white.
You are incorrect because yolks are yellow. Da da da!
Oh, how old is your daughter?
She is 15.
I got taken by a 15-year-old.
She still likes some of those really bad punny kind of jokes. You know, that's quite common for the really young kids, but
So Mitch, I don't like the fact that you're blaming this on your daughter when it was really your joke.
But I thought it was funny. I'm giving her credit. I'm not blaming her.
Okay.
Two more rapid meteor questions. God, I can't even get the words right. What is the greatest work of art in the world?
Pick Island by Lauren Harris.
Is that a song?
No, it's a painting done by one of the Group of Seven in my favorite part of Ontario.
We were talking the other day, you and I, about photographers. What was his name that we were talking about? The guy that did the candy store that sold for $1 million, 99 cents or whatever.
What is his name?
So you can't come up with it either.
Gursky.
Right.
Yeah.
What is the single most valuable thing you've learned?
If you're just be nice to people, and businesses and your personal life will be a lot better. That's it. It's very simple.
And that's quite good. Mm-hmm. All right. So much for the meteor round. How well did that work, guys? Was that fun?
Except embarrassing me. That was my bad.
Everybody knows about Canon rumors, right?
Yes.
Anyone that knows Canon stuff probably knows about it, yes.
What about Lens Rentals of Canada? Tell us a little bit about that.
Lens Rentals Canada. Started it just over three years ago. Modeled around lensrentals.com in the U.S.
Stolen from? Is that what you mean?
Stolen from, yes. we're not affiliated business-wise, but we are very good friends, and we talk all the time, and I go to Memphis and visit them. Nobody really knows about us. We ship coast to coast in Canada. It's a business that's growing. It's doing well. I think we're the only ones in Canada doing it to the scale that it's being done. Yeah, it's going really well. My wife actually runs the company day to day. I'm more there just to answer some tech questions or test lenses or anything like that. She's sort of the face of it now.
You get to just play with the gear. Is that what you're telling us?
I get to play with the gear, which is cool.
Dead silence.
Yes. It's a pretty broad question. I didn't know how long I had to go on for.
Well, in the pre-show, you did say you were just going to give one or two word answers. So I'm
true.
Thinking you're
and
doing
random grunts.
And I'm supposed to fill in the random grunts.
But yeah, no, we're a business that prides itself on being nice to people, customer service. For example, we sent a lens out to a guy. He got it in Calgary yesterday, a Nikon 500. Something happened in shipping, and it's out of alignment. So I'm actually going to drive 2.5 hours to Toronto today and buy another one and ship it to him, so he'll have it tomorrow for his trip to Africa on Monday. I think it's Africa he's going to.
Wow.
So that's sort of that's how we model our business. And he was nice to me, so I'm nice to him in return. So, yeah.
I'm going to have to remember that when I need something from you.
Ooh.
I've had experience with several places here in the United States, and most of them do a really, really good job of support.
Yes.
So I think it's a good model for other companies, because we've obviously all experienced bad support. So I'm very impressed to hear that you're driving. Couldn't you just order it for? Is there any online purchase place that could ship it overnight? As opposed to driving?
If he shipped it overnight, he wouldn't be able to ship it out tomorrow to the guy. He's got to get it today.
Yeah, I have to get the lens today. No, most places, especially with something like that, won't drop ship. We're not using a regular supplier. Our regular supplier doesn't have stock. He would probably drop ship it for us, but most won't do that if you don't have a working relationship. So have to get it and pay for it.
Well, that's awesome support. I applaud you.
Yeah. Thank you.
And that's just me. That's not a special sound effect.
Oh wow. That's exciting. That's exciting. Good for you.
Thank you.
How is Canon Rumors doing?
Canon Rumors is doing very well. It continues to grow. More and more people get active with it, read it, follow it. 2013 has been a bit of a down year for Canon. There's not a lot of crazy excitement for any new products, but hang around for 2014, and there will be.
Like what?
Like lots of stuff. We're going to see some higher-end stuff coming, and Cinema EOS stuff getting updated, and lots of lenses. And yeah, it's a photokina year, so it'll be a big year.
Does it really go based on that?
Looking at Canon's past announcements, it sort of does. Whether that's on purpose or not, I don't know. But it seems to be every 2 years stuff really flows.
Is that true for Nikon, too? Do you pay attention?
Yeah, they're pretty much their announcement cycles are about the same. Yeah, give or take 6 months on either side of something. But I'm sure they've got their spies and... They sort of wait for what Canon does, or Canon waits for what they do, and yeah.
Okay, I'm going to dive into a couple of the things. I kind of decided to merge the news with just chatting with you. Magic Lanterns just recently announced the 70 raw video capabilities. What do you think that is doing to Canon? Are they paying any attention to the folks over at Magic Lantern, or do they just think the consumers are all they got to worry about?
I think they're only really thinking about consumers. I don't think they pay too much attention to Magic Lantern. The people that are going to use that software are pretty much going to be, I think, more professional or indie professional type of people, which isn't the mass market. So it's sort of a niche thing, and a very cool niche thing. I do know that if Magic Lantern opened up a 1DX or something like that, then Canon would pay a lot of attention to that, and they'd probably be hearing from some lawyers.
Well, very specifically, yeah, I think Canon has told Alex and the team over at Magic Lantern, don't touch the 1DX or don't touch the Cinema EOS line, or we will be after you. So exactly. to some degree they are paying attention, but
I'm not gonna lie, the 14-bit color on this Magic Lantern versus the stock Canon video, I am thrilled about, and I can't wait to use it.
Have you tried it yet, Pamela?
Not yet. I'm anxious to use it. I've been, you know, in mom mode for the last couple weeks. So no, I'm excited. Honestly, I'm absolutely thrilled to try it.
Well, what cameras do you have, Pamela? We don't think we've ever asked you that question.
Yeah, the 7D, I got it when it first came out. It was kind of my congratulations, I'm divorced.
Awesome.
Nice. That should be Canon's next advertising campaign, by the way.
So, as far as everything else, I actually rent everything else I use. So I the 5D Mark III, the 5D Mark II. I just did 6 months on the C100 series. You know, put a camera in my hands. Doesn't even matter what it is. I'll use it. So I've even tested Sony's stuff and things like that. But for actually what I own, it's just the 7D, but I rent everything else.
So that's an interesting question. You didn't just say that you rented a C100 for 6 months, did you?
What we did is, we bought it and then sold it.
Oh,
so
okay.
It was cheaper for us to buy it and then just sell it when we were done.
Yeah.
And we actually made money overall.
You mean on the job or just by trading the
cheaper,
camera?
It was cheaper to obviously buy it than to rent it.
Right.
And then we sold it for a little more than half of what we paid for, but it was still overall we made out better considering if we were just to rent it.
Right.
So.
But you only got half? You must have beaten it up.
So it was a friend of ours, you know, like, hey, we don't need any more. Honestly, after using it for 6 months, I don't ever want to use it again.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Why is that?
You know how life, little things bug you? There was little things on that camera that just bugged the heck out of me that I would get frustrated with. And it wasn't anything big. It was only being able to zoom in once. Where on, you know, the other cameras, I can zoom in 10 times to make sure my focus was right or that sort of thing. It was those little things where some of the buttons were at or it drove me nuts that I got rid of it.
That's interesting. I've not heard that from anybody.
I know.
That's because six people are using the camera.
Oh, come on. Probably. That's not true. There are plenty of people using the C100. I get a lot of comments about that.
I wasn't happy with the ISO. We had to shoot a little bit of a higher ISO on our green screen and the way our lighting was. And it liked how it came out. I wasn't happy with it.
Huh. That's cool. That's interesting feedback. Canon, get that fixed, will you? So we went down a little bit of a rabbit hole there, but so you don't think, Craig, I'm talking to you again.
Yes.
Wake up. So you said that you don't think Magic Lantern is really influencing Canon at all. I mean, one of the things that's always bugged me, and this is a little tiny nit, sort of like what Pamela was just talking about, the fact that Canon doesn't put an intervalometer in the software. Ooh. Of the camera.
And yet, I have an answer to that one.
Do you? You know why?
I do know why. Straight from Canon itself, my Canon rep said that it's because they want the customers to buy the accessories. That was flat out. That's what it was.
And it must work for them because they keep doing it, which, I mean, realistically to me is another indicator that they're not going to do any of the things, or very few, if any, I should say, of the things that are in Magic Lantern, because they don't think the consumers want it, which is what Craig said, or they don't want to ruin the C100 line or, you know, the higher priced cameras. And so what we're going to continue getting from Canon is going to be disappointment for those who really want those features.
True. Absolutely. And I mean, marketing guys, Canon's very marketing driven. Marketing guys they don't use this stuff. They're into marketing. It's what they can put on a piece of paper to sell to consumers. And a 7D that shoots raw video, if they want something that's raw video, they could probably put it in an EOS 1 and charge a $3,000 premium and people would buy it. So why put it into a cheaper camera, even if the camera is fully capable of doing it? So they will continue that way of thinking.
Well, and even with the intervalometer and the cameras, I worked at a camera store for a year, and people would come in wanting to go buy an intervalometer, and I'd say flat out, okay, you know what? Go to Amazon, go to eBay, buy a $20 cheap China one because it's going to do the exact same thing and save yourself $100. And I would tell that to customers.
Not in front of your boss, of course.
Is that why you're no longer employed there?
No. But I wanted to be honest with people. I'm like, I don't want to waste $100 if I don't have to. As simple as that.
You're never going to succeed with an attitude like that. Sorry to break it to you. You must buy all the gear that you don't need. Isn't that what the whole race is for?
Don't we all?
More stuff.
The boy with the most toys when he dies wins, right?
Sadly.
Worked out well for Charles Foster Kane, so.
I do a workshop at NAB, a time-lapse workshop, and we even teach in the workshop, don't waste your money. Go get the cheap ones off of Amazon. People are happy with that. I'm happy with my several that I have.
And see, I just don't, I guess I am not a good marketing person because I would think that would be another reason somebody out there might buy Canon over Nikon, because Nikon puts it on their cameras.
Or buy Nikon over Canon?
Yeah. Nikon has an intervalometer built in. Did I say something wrong?
I don't remember that.
Nikon's got a gargantuan knock against them in the race for this space. And it's the fact that their cameras have such a limited ability to put lenses on their cameras. That's their biggest downfall in the race, in my opinion.
I agree.
Did you guys?
Yeah, like the,
go ahead.
The little features like intervalometer. I worked in camera retail. 99.9% of people don't even know what that is.
True.
So they're not going to buy a camera based on that. It's like people clamoring, oh, they have to put GPS on the cameras, GPS on the cameras. Again, 99% of people had really no idea or need or use for that. Now they're starting to do it as software is becoming more widely used for that sort of thing. But no, these are all little niche market features that I don't think really sell a bulk of their cameras.
Well, I will say in terms of the GPS issue, you know, the 6D and the new 70D have the Wi-Fi built in, which would have been something that I would have thought Canon would have really not put on some cameras. But I think they're being forced to because the consumers want to be able to upload their pictures to Flickr and whatever quickly.
Well, they've also got their new Project 1709 that's about to launch. So their whole image sharing thing. So I think instead of going to Flickr, it's going to go to Canon's own service. So I think that's why they're adding it to cameras now.
That's a good point.
Nice. But bottom line, I love my Canon cameras.
So you're not going to switch to Nikon or Sony?
I actually switched from Nikon.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, my very first DSLR camera was a Nikon D40.
Craig, what's your favorite camera?
My favorite camera?
Yeah.
That I use the most is the Leica M9.
Ooh, I love that one.
And why is that? Because it's small?
It's small, it's light. I love the 35-1.4. That's it. It requires no brain power to use. Minimal buttons. I know it's like the back of my hand. So,
and when you're in a group of other photographers, when they get around to you and say, "What camera do you have?" and you say, "I have Leica," there's nowhere to go but you win.
Mine looks like heck, though. Like I tore all the logos off it. It's dented. It's dinged. It's scratched. So, it's well used.
Nice.
What is the You, Craig, are more of a photographer than a video guy.
Absolutely. I am absolutely horrendous at shooting video, and I'm even worse at editing it. So it's, as I meet you guys and I learn things, I realize how it's so beyond photography. There's so many other variables to it that I find it very difficult.
Well, that makes you the perfect candidate for our upcoming tour that Barry and I are doing. How's that for a segue?
Sweet. See you in Toronto.
I honestly think that's a big misconception among photographers, is that video is so much harder. When I want to tell them that it's actually a lot simpler. You have all the tools, and let me show you how to use them. Like it's. I honestly think coming from a photographer, you'd make such a better videographer.
I believe that's very true.
Can I say I disagree with both of you? Just so I'm kind of the curmudgeonly person.
Do it, Barry. Do it.
Go, Barry. Go.
And you can tell me if I'm completely off base, Craig. But I think that true photographers, you know, either ones that are working professionals or they do it for fun, I think for most people, shooting video does not have that same just pure joy that when people walk around and snap shots of stuff. It requires a lot more brain power and a lot more to be able to do it well. So even though they can do it, I think it takes the fun out for most photographers, to do it kind of what you would say, you know, I guess this would be the way to put it. You have things that you do for your job, and then you have the things you do in your spare time that you enjoy doing. I think that video takes the joy out of the picture taking side of it for photographers. And I don't think that just because they have the tools, I think the language of motion is different than that of stills. So I don't think if they're just going to use it like they do a still camera, I do not think they're more well-equipped than others to do it. I think they can. They have the ability to learn it, but I don't think it's just something they slap on, hit record, and now magically they have a leg up on other people to make good quality video.
However, if they already have the eye, they already understand lighting, and they're interested, but they just think it's overwhelming, being able to zone in on, say, hey, you understand aperture, you understand f-stops, you understand how it all works. If I can show you a couple tools on being able to shoot the video, and they get excited, then they have that leg up because they already know, they already have that composition and everything else, the tools that they've learned as a photographer. And it makes it easier to teach them how to do the video.
Well, they have the leg up in terms of how to capture an image, but most of the photographers I've worked with, they have a hard time understanding how lenses work differently with motion and how to do the motion and then how to craft the edit, because they're used to looking at a still image, having a moment, and then editing for that. And now when they have to cut things together into, you know, a wider piece,
that I agree.
That's
with
a whole different brain functionality than what they're used to. So yes, in terms of understanding f-stop lenses and how to expose properly, they have a leg up there. But I think the whole package is a learning thing. It's not something they just pick up and it's like, oh, good. Since I did photography, now I'm a video person.
But things like Photoshop, where you can teach, you can actually do video, simple video in Photoshop, makes it easier for those photographers who do want to learn video. It's an easier transition because they already understand Photoshop. And let me show you how to add video in Photoshop. It's really quite simple. So there are tools out there making that easier.
Yes, Craig.
For me, I think it's video takes a lot longer to tell the story. An image can just happen. There it is. The image tells the story. It took 1/2000th of a second, and there it is, and you can show it to people. Whereas video's an extreme time commitment to tell a story, and that's sort of what not turns me off about it, but makes it difficult for me. Like it's not instant gratification. It's not.
I have a quote that you can use. I'm going to work it out right here on the podcast. But it's something like this, that a picture is an instant and a video is a moment. But to capture the instant takes a moment for photos, but it takes a day to capture in video.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
Let's see.
I like it.
To 29 minutes and 58 seconds into the recording, let's mark that one down.
Here we go.
Famous quotes from Barry Andersson. I do agree with you, Barry. I mean, it's a very interesting conversation. I am more of a born photographer because that's what I started with. And when for example, when I was on vacation, it was 2 days before I even remembered, oh, I need to shoot some video. because I was so gratified personally by shooting the stills that I was getting. And again, it was in Death Valley, so I wasn't even thinking about it because it was way too hot to get the tripod out and do everything else. But I do think that's the perfect segue for anybody out there that's listening, that Barry and I will be doing a training tour this fall in September and October and November. And we will be announcing that on Planet 5D next week. So keep your eyes peeled on Planet 5D for that great information, if I say so myself.
Cool. I'll buy you dinner in Toronto.
Really?
Yeah. I like your dinners. I'll take you up on that.
Yeah. I really enjoyed the one we had at NAB this year. So.
Yeah. That'll be fun.
That'll be great. Too bad Pamela's not coming along.
I was feeling a bit left out. I know.
I'm sorry.
Wheel. The fourth wheel.
I know, right?
Go ahead.
No, I was just saying that as a photographer and a videographer, for me, I love being able to do both arts. And I am very satisfied being able to learn and grow as an artist in both arts. But I love the fact there are just photographers and then there are just videographers. The world needs people that are just unique and excited about one venue. That's my 2 cents.
That was 32 minutes and 3 seconds, the quote from Pamela. Craig, what do you think is coming down the pike in terms of the megapixel war? Is that over? I mean, I know you've talked briefly about this major 45 megapixel something or other.
No, it's definitely not over. And if anyone has used a D800, the files that come out of it are absolutely remarkable. And every time I use one, I'm still blown away by it. I'm not of the camp that we have enough megapixels we don't need anymore. I think if we can... we can make them good pixels, and make images that are high dynamic range, good ISO performance, all that stuff. I think more the merrier. Canon definitely has one coming in 2014. How many? I don't know. There's obviously a bunch of sensors in testing. The last one we heard about, and it's actually from a pretty good source. I think Photography Bay got it too. That like 70 plus megapixels is in testing. So if they can do it well, then, memory's cheap. So I don't think there's an issue with buying new memory cards and all that jazz. So
Craig, let me ask you this. If they're rumoring the 75 megapixel, is it a single chip 75 megapixel, or are they going the Foveon route where it's a triple layer sensor capturing the different colors on three different sensors? Therefore, when you combine them, you get the 75 pixels.
That's a great question, because that's one I've been wondering and discussing with people, because I know Canon has had patents for sensors and layered sensors and all that jazz. So what I had heard about the 75 megapixel camera was it fired crazy fast. So that meant a high frame rate, which if it's that many true megapixels, I don't know how fast of a frame rate the camera could really fire, just for write speeds. And I don't think Digic 6 could, even if you had two of them, could handle an 80 megapixel file at 10 frames a second. We've been quietly wondering that. I haven't been able to get anyone to confirm or deny, though. Good question.
I believe it's alien technology. If we can't confirm, go with alien technology.
Pamela, what were you going?
No, I quickly Googled about the Canon 75 plus megapixel DSLR, and they may use a new stacked three-layer sensor from what I'm reading. I don't know what I'm not all technical, so I'm not sure what that means, but that's what the internet is saying.
But it must be true.
I'm guessing you're getting that from canonrumors.com?
No.
No, I didn't post that. I think Northlight posted it.
Okay.
Petapixel.
And yeah.
Well, Petapixel just picks up everything that other people post.
Yeah.
Much like I'm accused of doing.
You burned yourself. That's pretty good.
Yeah, I'm good at that. Craig, when you get rumors, how much work do you have to go through, or has it just become intuitive to know whether something somebody sent you is potentially true or not and worth publishing?
It's become pretty intuitive now. There's just markers you look for. I get still 80% of the stuff that comes in I know isn't true. And when I see things on other sites that get posted, I know they're not true, and I feel bad for them. But I also, I'm friends with a lot of people now in the industry, and I do hear stuff that doesn't end up on the site. So that can help confirm if I hear things through more anonymous channels. As the people I've been friends with, I don't break their trust. If they say don't post it, I don't post it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's pretty intuitive. It's getting easier. I'm still wrong sometimes. Sometimes I don't read something the right way, but I'm getting better at it.
Well, that was my other question. Because, I mean, you and I talk often, and, you know, I talk to Canon periodically, which isn't as much as it used to be because I don't think they like me anymore. But that's a whole other story. but the people that I have spoken with, you know, just from Canon constantly tell me, well, Canon Rumors is always wrong. They never get anything right. And, you know, they just generally dislike you.
Yeah, that's Canon USA.
Correct.
Canon USA is, they are completely different than any other Canon subsidiary I've ever had conversations with, talked to. The rest of the planet likes the site, and a lot of them even admit, oh, I check it every morning, see if you're right, see if you're wrong, see what's going on. but Canon USA, there's just a smugness or an arrogance, or I don't know what it is. And I mean, I'm wrong until I'm right. So they, yeah, I've never had a great relationship with Canon USA. I don't understand.
Well,
I'm part of their marketing team. Like, it's, and they don't have to pay me.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
I mean, I've tried to have that discussion with them, and they don't seem to want to listen, but that's neither here nor there.
No.
I'm pausing because I just had a question in my mind, and it just went poof. Oh, have you, do you go back and look at rumors you've posted and kind of keep a running tab of when you've been right and wrong, or is it
yes, just I do.
Become intuitive?
No, I...
So what's your percentage?
It's better than 50%, actually. See, a lot of stuff comes out, and it's kind of vague because the information out there is vague.
Wait a minute. Wait, vague. What does vague mean?
Like, vague? They're not... Vague. Yeah, vague.
Vague. Okay.
It's my Canadian vague. Accent, I guess. Vague.
Eh. Take off.
Eh.
okay, thanks.
So, I mean, people want the full spec list of a product a year before it comes out. And, I mean, that's not going to happen. Like, the original 7D rumor, I think we spoke about it 8 months before the camera, and we were exactly right. But it wasn't everything nailed down to a specific specification. It was 6 months before the 1DX was announced that we said there was going to be an amalgamation of the lines. There would be no 1DS Mark IV, and the one there would be no 1D Mark V. It would be a 1DX, yada, yada, yada. So that's correct. So we have a lot of stuff like that where the information was correct. It's just it wasn't really articulate in what was coming. Most of the time, the big spec lists come a week or two before the product actually gets announced. The odd time you get it sooner, which we do sometimes. But most of the time, once it reaches out and gets to marketing departments, that's when the leaks all come about. Canon itself, they've tightened up their ship. There's not a lot of leaks from Canon anymore. but I remember when I think we posted the 5D Mark III specs weeks before, a month and a half before. And I mean, people were telling me I was wrong. And we even had the price down, and then you turn out to be right, and those people go away. But not always right. Lenses are really tough to nail down. I think production is the big thing with lenses. So they may have something, here it is, it's a product, but we have to be able to make it. I think there's issues with that. Especially since the tsunami, I honestly don't think Nikon or Canon or anyone else has fully recovered from that yet.
Really?
I still think there's issues, and especially with production of lenses. So yeah, we're better than 50%. I think better than 60%. But sometimes you read stuff and we're wrong, or I think sometimes honestly products change and marketing gets a hold of them, or R&D finds something they want to change it, and so things get either delayed or changed.
Well, yeah, I think part of the issue that you may deal with, especially like Canon, is they're going to remember the things that weren't right. They're not going to remember all the ones that were.
That's correct. Even if they remember the ones that are right, they don't want it out that early. That's the reason they don't like him. They don't know he's wrong all the time.
Well, the discussion I've had with Canon is, you know, they may dislike the fact that Canon Rumors puts out some early specs, but Canon has gotten into this game now, like with the 1DX, for example, where they announced it and they didn't actually release it for 6 to 8 months. Now, you know, their argument to me against Canon Rumors has always been, well, you know, they're squishing the market right now. If people want to buy a 7D and Canon Rumors releases the information early, well, if they release the information on the 1DX 8 months before they're actually going to produce, you know, start delivering them, aren't they killing their own 1D market throughout that whole period? They're doing it themselves, but they don't see that.
And I mean, they're a just-in-time company. So there's not some big warehouse full of products that, because of Canon Rumors, we can't sell. So when they announce a new 70 to 200 or a 24 to 70 or a new 7D, well, you can buy a 7D today for $1,000 if you wait for the right sale. If I talk about a 7D Mark II, that's fine. But when the 7D Mark II comes out and it costs $2,000,
right?
They're going to sell the rest of those 7Ds for the $1,000. It's not even going to be an issue. So that way of thinking is flawed and wrong.
So, in case Canon's listening, I don't agree with any of these people.
Well,
only Canon USA. I've had this discussion with other Canon subsidiaries, and they agree with me. And they agree with you, Mitch, and it's, yeah.
Well.
There you go.
Anyway, let's move on before I get even deeper with Canon USA. So when is the 7D Mark II coming? When do you have any estimates?
Second half of 2014.
Still that far out?
That's from a known. I think they really need to see how the 70D does. And whether there is truly a market for a high-end APS-C camera, and how high of a how far it needs to go and what it needs to be spec'd as to differentiate it and keep people buying it, even though the camera will probably cost more than a 60.
Wow.
So what are your thoughts on the 70D, the 70D?
I think it's spec'd cool. I haven't touched one yet. I think it'll do well.
Have you seen some of the early live view video autofocus demos?
I have not seen. Oh, I've seen it once.
I'm pretty impressed. I'm way behind on publishing a couple of videos I have on Planet 5D. Planet5D.com. But I'm pretty impressed, and I can't wait to get my hands on it from a filmmaker standpoint. You know, that we've always said that manual focus is the way to go. But I've been pretty impressed from the couple of demos videos that I've seen, especially with the touchscreen. You know, like to be able, and I know Canon's not too thrilled, at least on the pro level, about the touchscreen, but I love the heck out of my T4i because I can touch that screen in focus and, you know, expect things to be in focus, and I don't have to worry about flipping, you know, turning the lens. But anyway, I'm very impressed with the 70D from what I've seen so far.
But isn't that going to be more appealing to your soccer parents wanting to do video of their kids at a soccer game rather than a pro consumer videographer?
That's what they want you to believe, and I'll let Craig answer that too. But I think the longer pros get used to things like the iPhone, where they can just touch and focus, there will be situations where it will be faster and easier to just do, let the camera do the focus, and Barry may have something to say about this too, but eventually people will get, some pros will get used to it, not all of them.
Well, when Sony came out with that autofocus and video, and I did the testing on that, and it drove me nuts because as I was interviewing this guy, every time he moved, the autofocus kept jumping, and it drove me nuts. That's why I'm a little skeptical. Not just a little, but
And the T4i does that too on me if I try to use that, but from what I have seen of the 70D, this is much better.
Yeah, and you should be able to turn off servo so it just stays focused where you want it.
Right.
So it doesn't come in and out. But we went through this, too, with still photography when live view came on cameras. not live view on the 20DA. That was like sort of the first live view camera. But the stuff later, that it was just not pure anymore. But landscape photographers started to fall in love with it because they could check exposure live.
Right.
They could set grad filters and stuff. And instead of trying to line them up with your eye, you could just move it up and down on this big, beautiful screen. And now it's become a feature that landscape photographers and the likes aren't using it every single time they make a photo, but they couldn't live without it in a lot of situations, or they really enjoy the feature now. So features like that, while they're going to make some people's lives easier, other people aren't going to switch over, but there could be situations where that is just going to be, wow, I can't believe I didn't have this before.
Right.
So...
Pamela, did you want to ask something?
No, it just does nothing for me.
What do you think, Craig, the likelihood of touchscreen coming to pro level like the 5D and 7D is?
Oh, it'll come. Absolutely. I think eventually the whole back of the camera is going to be a screen.
Like the Blackmagic Cinema camera?
Yeah, pretty much. So you're going to have like a 4.5-5-inch screen on the back, and there's going to be touch-sensitive things on it, and all your controls and everything are going to be... I don't think that's happening next year, but I think that's where it'll probably end up, or end up something like that.
I really hope that they don't take and put everything in a touchscreen and take off some of the buttons and some of the controls on the back of the camera, because I think that will make usability go down overall. I'm sure there's a lot of things they can do, but I find when I'm shooting a lot, sometimes I don't want to be looking at live view or looking at the back, so I can find them physically with my thumb. And I think if they take that away, that will be a huge step back, even for the parts that would be better forward. So they better make sure they have a usability study before they start removing everything off the back.
Agreed.
True. But they're going to want to put larger LCDs on the back of these cameras.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I'm all for touchscreen and larger. I just don't like it if they decide to put everything in there. And even the Blackmagic camera, even though I like it, because the buttons kind of are all the same. You know, the one nice thing about the back of the Canon is you're like, you know, physically they all feel different. So outside of the four buttons on the left, you know, you can kind of in the dark find anything. And go, okay, that's yes, this is the one I want to use. But
that's
when
true.
All buttons feel the same, you're kind of like, cripes, I got to get a light and go look at this now when it's dark or whatnot. And it's just, it makes it that much harder to just operate.
I agree.
What about an iOS-like user interface? Do you think we're going that direction?
I think we already are. There's people out there, you know, like we interviewed the other day, there's people that are incorporating that third party to work with the cameras.
Mm-hmm.
Craig seems stumped.
I think we should go back to Hi8 camcorders. They were much easier to figure out than this. The video image was not as good, but it was very simple to use.
It's not that it wasn't as good. Think of it as an art. It's art.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, he's back to the one answer, one word answers.
It's a, I don't know. I hope not. I don't really like iOS, but.
it theoretically, if you did something like iOS, you could open up a simple Magic Lantern add-on kind of thing, which I would really love to see. But again, with Canon's marketing sense, I'm not sure how long it's going to take to get there. There are cameras out there right now that are running Android, so there are some semblances that we may get there eventually.
Probably. They're always going to have to find a new way to sell things. So.
And the other question along that line is, what do you think about the whole mirrorless thing? Will DSLRs get rid of their viewfinder and we'll all be mirrorless?
Maybe one day. I think the EVF has to get a lot better. I think it needs to be like you're looking through a prism. And until they can make those, I think the mirror will be around, at least in pro level cameras, still cameras. Whether they start doing it with Rebels and stuff, that could definitely happen. But yeah, I think electronic viewfinders have to be better than they are.
I agree.
You guys are all off surfing the web and not listening to anything that Craig says.
No, you're just letting it sink in. Let people just kind of, you know, bathe in the wisdom.
Ooh.
Oh. But I do, you know, Sony, when the Sony came out with their mirrorless cameras, honestly, I loved it. It was great. I loved how smaller they are. I loved the quality that I was getting from it. And so I honestly would like to see Canon and Nikon make more higher end cameras with those mirrorless. I think that the technology's there, and that through time they can make some really amazing products with it.
Well, I guess my question is, we've just sort of talked around two sides of that. One is that we love something that we want to be able to put in our pocket, and then at the same time, Barry and Craig both said, well, they like the larger LCDs and they want to see bigger. So I think, Is that going to make us have still large body cameras, which I personally like better than the small ones, but where do you think we're going that way?
I think what you've got then is two lines where you're going to get people buying both, so they sell more stuff. And that's I think that's the goal, is why do people have one camera? They should have three. And that's I think that's the way it's going. The latest, like EOS M super sale, I think everybody that was wondering about it that already had Canon SLRs when it became that cheap, by what I heard B&H sold of them, people jumped in. And I'm getting a lot of comments from people saying, I love my 5D3, but I also love this little EOS M I can just throw in my pocket. I'm glad I have both now. So that's...
The nice thing is we can have our cake and eat it too.
Yes.
We don't have to choose.
So.
I was reading an article this morning that, my brain just went totally dead. Rodney Charters posted on Twitter about the history of digital photography and how it's become so popular that it you know, it's continuing to grow. Obviously, the iPhone is the leading camera at this point that people use. But at the same time, we had a discussion with my uncle who was in town the other day about the fact that, you know, everybody is sort of no longer in the moment. You go to an event and there are so many people with their camera phones up that you start to be concerned that everybody's living in their camera as opposed to in the moment itself.
It's exactly what Canon wants, remember?
Well,
that was in the special memo that we were all sent.
That's true.
No, I agree with that point. I self-regulate that. So if I go with my family, my phone stays in the car. If I go to a concert, the phone stays in the car. If I go to a baseball game, the phone stays in the car. Except for the last one, so I'm lying a bit about that. I had a work thing to do. But, I self-regulate that because I find it very odd when you go out. And it's a cliche, but there's a table full of five people and there's four phones out.
Right.
And nobody's interacting. Nobody's talking. Nobody's watching anything. And, So I definitely self-regulate that. I'm aware of it. I think I was guilty of it for a while.
I think it's healthy to self-regulate that. I went to the Justin Timberlake Jay-Z concert the other week, and I purposely left my phone at the hotel, and I get to the venue, and it was an amazing sight, seeing everybody with their cell phones out, but I was kind of glad I didn't have mine. It was, I enjoyed the moment.
Absolutely.
Then there's the whole issue of being able to take a DSLR to a concert. I went to a concert not too long ago, and before I went, I called the venue and said, if I bring my DSLR, will I be able to bring it in? And they said no. And it just drove me crazy because I was smart enough to leave it home because I didn't want to have to go back to the car. But why is it that iPhones can take video and photos at a concert, and yet the poor DSLR guys are screwed?
Isn't there some licensing or rules about shooting concerts that, like, pros can only really shoot it the first three songs or something? So it's about rights to the images, and somebody owns that concert. So having high quality photos taken by just anybody is frowned upon. Because I know one girl that shoots a lot of concerts, and she's out after two or three songs, can't take another photo.
Yeah, I found that to be true when I was talking to Sarah Colleton.
That's who I'm actually meeting with today. But is it?
Yeah. It amazed me when she said she can only take photos during the first three. But I mean, and that's with a press pass. They know she's coming to shoot photos.
Yeah, like I think the production company or somebody owns the concert.
Yes.
So that's who's in control of imagery. So I understand the no DSLR thing, and I kind of agree with it.
Have you actually seen a good iPhone video or photo from a concert? Really?
No. The only ones worth watching are when something crazy happens, and you're like, just to see the crazy moment. But yeah, I mean, the quality's abysmal. So, but it's the same thing too. Like when you go to a wedding, when I used to shoot weddings, and there'd be 15 digital SLRs just in your way. So I think it would be the same thing at concerts if that stuff was sort of allowed to come in and just be in everybody's way.
Well, but I would contend that the phones are in my way.
I would 100% agree with you. I think that's just impossible to regulate.
That's true.
All right. We have been at this for 58 minutes and 7 seconds, and I absolutely love talking to Craig and could talk to him for another hour. Barry, do you or Pamela have any questions that you're just dying to get out before we let Craig drive 2.5 hours to buy a camera?
No, I kind of feel bad for the guy that needs the lens, so I think we should let him go.
He's a very nice customer, so I don't mind doing it for him.
I'd be like, get off the phone, go now. I wouldn't be this patient with you. So
honestly, for that, I want to see some of his pictures he brings back.
Absolutely, I'll hit him up for some.
Yeah,
that'd be great. All right, well, thank you so much, Craig, for being our guest. We absolutely love Canon Rumors. I read it religiously.
Thanks.
I can't order anything from Canon. I'm sorry, from Lens Rentals Canada, because I'm here in the United States and you don't ship to me.
No.
I might be at the Toronto Film Festival, and I will hit you up.
That's cool. I would provide you anything you'd like.
Oh, love it.
C100.
Gonna buy one specially for her.
While you're at the store, pick up a second one. She really wants to use it again.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Well, that's a good question. Are you renting much film gear, or are you not in that business at this point?
We haven't got into that space yet. I need to hire somebody that knows the stuff.
Barry's available.
If I can't tech support it over the phone, I shouldn't be renting it, which I can do with a camera or a lens. But video, I'd sound like an idiot, and I would just annoy people. So.
Well, and you'd only give them one word answer, so
that exactly. Anyway, I look forward to seeing your tour schedule, see you when you're in Toronto. Hopefully I'm in Canada at that time.
I certainly hope so, because I want that free dinner. Oh, you didn't say it was free. Never mind.
You said he'd take us out.
I'll show you where a restaurant is.
Barry and I just have absolutely loved spending time with you at NAB. So anytime we get to spend with you is a bonus. So I hope.
Awesome. I feel the same
way. I say we schedule a podcast now for NAB with him.
Okay. Yes. We'll do it. We'll do it live from the floor.
Live from the floor, yeah.
Nice. That'd be fun.
Craig's always up for anything.
It's true. Pretty easy going.
All right. Here's my little outro kind of stuff. I want to thank our sponsors. Oh, wait. We don't have any. If you guys are interested in listening, I highly encourage you to subscribe in iTunes to the Planet 5D podcast. I want you to be patient, however, because I just discovered this week that the iTunes Planet 5D audio only version, because there is a video version, for some reason it hasn't updated in a year, and I don't go in every week and look to see if all the podcasts are there. So I don't know why they aren't there, but subscribe to us in iTunes and please give us ratings and tell us what a wonderful job we're doing, or don't respond at all. No, just kidding. If we're not doing something right, or if you have any suggestions, please let me know. You can write to me at planet5d.com/contact. Obviously, Craig is over at canonrumors.com and lindsayrollscanada.com. You're on Twitter, too, as well, aren't you?
Yes, at Canon Rumors Guy.
Canon Rumors Guy. Did somebody else have Canon Rumors already?
Yes.
Huh.
Someone beat me to it.
So a squatter has your proper user ID, and they're not using it very well, are they?
No.
Well, again, thanks so much for being on the show, Craig. We hope to have you on next year or sooner when great, exciting rumors come out. And Pamela and Barry, thank you so much for tuning in today and helping. Tuning in.
Awesome.
Don't forget to turn in next week when we have a special guest who I have no idea who it is yet. But we'll either have a special guest or Barry and Pamela and I will just ramble on incessantly about something.
Is that a hint for me to get on that?
Well, I sent you a very cool one, and nobody,
I like it.
Nobody responded. It was like sending something out into dead air, and it's somebody that has never been interviewed audio. He's done some text interviews, and I won't say his name until we get total everything scheduled, but if we can get this guy on the air, I'm going to be jumping up and down with excitement. So keep your eyes and ears peeled to Planet 5D for that podcast coming up.
Awesome.
And we did you want to say something, Pamela, before I do the final out?
Nope, I'm good.
You breathed, so I thought, oh, she might want to say something. Stop breathing. Barry, stop breathing. Thanks, everyone, for listening, and don't forget to tune in next week. And on behalf of Pamela and Barry, this is Planet Mitch saying over and out.
I think we need to do a little more all-weather testing.
We've had a couple of cardiac arrests down here, too.
We got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again.
That was definitely an E-ticket.
Roger, 0-G, and I feel fine.
Returning him safely to the Earth.